happy Black Friday, and may you not get trampled in a mall.
Thanks, Becca. That's one of my goals every year, is to not get trampled at a mall.
Gosh, sometimes I have like a recurring nightmare where I'm just driving, but then I really need the bathroom and I go in the mall, but then it's Black Friday and I get trampled.
Oh my gosh, that's like the scariest thing ever. Please, let's not let that happen ever.
Well, I won't let that happen to you or to me, because we're going to buy all of our gifts on Kickstarter this year, right?
That is like the perfect solution. Yes, let's go on Kickstarter, find all the great games that we can give all of our friends and family.
I want you to run, not jog, to your Kickstarter console, which you have one specifically for Kickstarter, I know that you do, for Call to Adventure, Epic Adventures, and not the OG Epic Adventures that was on Kickstarter a few years ago, the OGL, baby! That's right, Open Game License, which is the Dungeons & Dragons IP that they've made licensable to other people so you can do stuff like Ranger and Cleric and all that. Anyway. Call to Adventure Epic Origins is a 1-4 player game. It plays in 30 to 60 minutes. Now, in the original, you're building up like basically a classic fantasy novel. You've got a hero with a humble origin and a heroic motivation and a grand destiny. And in this one, you're basically creating a D&D character. You have this sort of like choose your own adventure mechanic where you're drafting cards based on what your player's already been able to level up and do and your existing attributes. And you're drafting these epic events and interactions from the communal board, earning you even more attributes to help you complete more things in the future. Now, it doesn't have your regular dice rolling. Does it, Ruel?
Speaking of OG, you're rolling runes. They're not dice. They are literally runes that you're doing. And I imagine back in the day when people would play games, instead of dice, they had runes. And this is how they played games.
So the Epic Origin expansion, it can play standalone or it's compatible with the original game. And it's got that same structure and the flavors in it. But this one's like a fantasy RPG that you may have heard of. You've got classes and experience bonuses and your own big bad nemesis to defeat to fulfill your destiny. Now, something different about this version of the game, Epic Origins, is that before any player can win the game, there is a cooperative aspect to fight the big bad together, which I think is really cool. I like when competitive and cooperative intermingle.
You had me at choose your own adventure. The fact that you do that style of, you know, I love books, I love choose your adventures, I grew up reading them, and to create characters using this type of system, it's got me all excited about it. Yes.
And a part of Epic Origins is that you can convert the character that you create through the gameplay into a 5th edition character sheet at the end of the game, which is super sweet. I mean, character creation's always fun, but like having one already made for you from a different game, that's perfect.
All of a sudden you got this character with a backstory and you've lived and breathed in it already and you're ready to go adventuring with it. So yeah, this is gonna be awesome.
What else is happening out in the world, Ruel?
Oh, all kinds of things happen in the world, Becca. And right now, the thing I'm most excited about is Karaj-e-Tal, and that is Artisans of the Taj Mahal. So, in 1631, Emperor Shah Jahan lost the love of his life, and the legend goes that he was so grief-stricken that he wanted to build, you know, this amazing mausoleum to honor his lost love. It took 22 years, but in Artisans of the Taj Mahal, you're only going to take about 90 minutes to build the Taj Mahal. From designer Amit Gaj, 2-4 players can play as Karajgars, or artisans, to build the Taj Mahal, and you're going to do this through tile laying, worker placement, and resource management. You're going to complete various levels of the Taj Mahal by placing your artisans on different spaces that yield resources. Those resources you're going to use to build the different layers of the Taj Mahal, and you're going to generate income, but along with that comes an evolving marketplace. So yeah, you're going to generate income, but those may help your opponents as well. And of course, you want to be the one that wins the Emperor's favor because of your amazing artwork and your contributions to it. And after about 90 minutes, you're going to see who has won the Emperor's favor.
I just love the idea behind the Taj Mahal, that it was made for love and it's this lasting symbol of that in the world, and that's what they wanted to make a game about. And this handcrafted design of the miniature of Shah Jahan is really nice. I love the detail.
Yeah, it's got, you know, all the worker meeples and components are wooden, and you also have elephant meeples, which, come on, you get an elephant meeple, I'm all over it. I love my animal meeples.
Yeah, you had me at animeeple.
All right, Becca, what else we got here?
Well, there's a lot going on in the world, as we've previously discussed, Ruel. And as you may or may not know, I am sometimes interested in such things as politics, as is the game Hegemony, Lead Your Class to Victory. So this is a 1-4 player asymmetrical game. It's a political simulation, which sounds like, ugh, turn off, what are they doing here? But guess what? It looks freaking fantastic. In this game, it is themed around politics, where you play as the working class, the capitalist class, the middle class, or the state. And one of these asymmetrical fascist factions is going to win here. Okay, it's for 14 plus, 45 minutes per player, so it's a crunchy one. She's a weighty girl, and I'm really into this. It also has this really cool educational booklet with a crash course of all the political concepts that the game is drawing from that's just for backers, so you'd have to back it online to get that. And hey, well, I mean, tell me how much we love asymmetry. It's the new game buzzword. Like, some people have made entire podcasts about asymmetrical games. Hashtag Woodland War Machine. Just a little bit about how this plays. You've got a big giant board, lots of moving pieces. Obviously a super serious theme, but that's kind of just the backdrop for really strategic gameplay, planning many turns ahead. So I'm really curious as to how well this game is able to implement kind of the feeling of what it would be like. Hegemony just means like domination and the leading party, like leadership. So, if you win with the capitalist class, is that kind of like winning as the Nazis and Secret Hitler? I don't know. We'll find out.
Wow, this game has so much going on. And, I just theme-wise, I know this is your jam, Becca. And also, what I like about it is it's huge, it's epic, it's talking all these big issues, yet it's not going to take 12 hours to play like, you know, certain games that we may have played in the past.
Is there a stopwatch still on my phone on my stopwatch?
11:47.
Is that how long we played Twilight Imperium last weekend?
It didn't feel anything like 11 hours, 47 minutes, folks. It felt like 11 hours, 46 minutes to me. So it was much shorter.
I've thought a lot about what kind of a game I would make if I ever made a game. Obviously, I'm not it's a lot harder than just making your first game. But I really like that they grabbed a theme that was so all-encompassing and epic, but have distilled it down to like, well, what if it's just about who's in the ruling party and there are these archetypes? And I like the simplicity and complexity of it. Like, they didn't make it too expansive, and they're really not trying to give a message as far as I can see, although, in my opinion, when we play it on my table, it will have that.
I think that's a wonderful way of putting it, right? You're taking these big, complex ideas, but distilling it down to something where it's playable, rather than, like, you won't have, like, tons of different charts you gotta go to and different, you know, things you gotta resolve. No, it's still gonna be a streamlined experience at the tabletop.
What else you wanting to play? What's gonna look good on your table?
There's all kinds of stuff that looks good on my table, and this next one is gonna look fantastic. Becca, it's cute animals in spaceships. Pew, 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 pew. Starfighters Rapid Fire is a real-time dice rolling game, and folks, if you know me, you know I love dice. You know, I love rolling those dice, and I love doing it in real time with my opponents. And what we're doing here in Starfighters Rapid Fire is rolling these dice simultaneously to assign them to various functions on your starfighter. And all the starfighters are, hey, what's that magic word? Asymmetric. They're different. So we all have different functions that we can do. We're going to charge up our system with these dice. And then when you're ready, you're going to hit the big red button and yell fire. That's where you're going to start shooting at your opponents. You got torpedoes. You got lasers. You're going to maneuver around the map. You're going to adjust your shields and take special actions that are unique to your starfighter.
Yeah, this looks great, Ruel. I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy, huge fan. Yeah. This is kind of that animals in spacesuits thing going on. Really adorable. And it looks like it plays in only 30 minutes. I mean, quick to get on the table, quick little warm-up game or a cool-down game after, you know, You have created a hegemony for the entire society.
I am excited to play this. I love everything about this. And what is it called? Is it called anthropomorphic? Is that what we call those cute little animal thingies?
Yeah, human-like.
Yeah, so folks, if you're ready to get your anthropomorphism on, this is the game for you.
For the ADD and ADHD among us, simultaneous gameplay is sometimes very necessary. Love when you can just be rolling dice all at the same time. You don't have to wait for your turn.
Yeah.
Okay, can we slow down a little bit? Because I've got, I told you, a lot of Christmas shopping to do. And I gotta go to some bookstores, okay? So, is there a game for that?
There is. I'm glad you brought that up, Becca. There is a game. This is our honorable mention for this episode. Actually, not one, but two games. American Bookshop and CINDERELLA'S Dance. These are two trick-taking games from Twin Lions Do Books. They are a bookshop and board game producer in Tokyo, Japan. So the first one is American Bookshop, and it was inspired by creators' experience working in American Bookshop. 3 to 5 players. All the cards are themes as books, Becca. I know you love books. I love books. We're definitely going to play this one. So what you're trying to do is you're trying to collect the most copies of one book to score points while making sure you don't have less than half as many books as your opponents, because those are negative points. So trick-taking for 3 to 5 players and with a bookshop theme, I'm all about it. This is, you know, my jam personally.
Hold on, I gotta read this aloud. There's a quote. It says, "When I was working in a bookstore in America, there was an unhappy manager who took my precious playing cards. I was a little bit upset, and it inspired me to make a game that he couldn't find out about, a game using books. That's what we call the American Bookshop." Wow, that floors me, because my instinct was like, Tokyo is so peaceful and lovely and organized and orderly. Why would they want to make a game about an American bookshop? I see, out of spite.
And you know what? They didn't just make a game about a bookshop. They also made a trick-taking game called CINDERELLA'S Dance, which is really cool because it's a game for 2 players, Becca. And as you know, trick-taking is normally 3 to 5 players. But here, they've done a 2-player game that only takes about 10 minutes to play. And it's based on, like, you're dancing at a ballroom, right? And what you're doing is trying to anticipate your partner's moves, because if you're like me, you don't want to be stepping on, you know, your partner's feet. And here, you're playing cards that don't have suits, they're just numerical, and you're just playing a card that is either up to 3 higher than the previously played card. So then you can win the trick. It's a simple, elegant game, and it only takes 10 minutes to play. And what I like about this is 2 players, that's usually my jam, because that's what Michelle and I, that's my main gaming partner, and we do like to dance, but we don't dance too often these days, so this is perhaps one way we can dance, is through the magic of trick-taking. So that's CINDERELLA'S Dance.
Well, friends, thank you so much for watching this good-looking Kickstarter. We're going to take some time off for the holidays, so we'll see you next year, and maybe in a different format. Who knows? If you enjoyed this, please subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you later for more good times. Bye.